probably would have pretty much been what it was like when I bought it.
Right.
And you know, to go back to why that would be is that, you know, I saw Buddy Holly holding one. Buddy Holly played one. And you know, all those records that he made, it sounded like it was really, really quiet. You know, and he played it like an acoustic guitar a lot of the time. So it had that initial appeal to me when I was a kid. But then somewhere down the road, I went to the Marquee and saw Buddy Guy. And I heard Buddy Guy on an album called Folk Festival of the Blues, where he was the new kid on the block playing with Muddy and Howlin' Wolf, and they were all singing, and he just launched into this solo that killed everybody dead, you know. And then I went to see him at play. Man, I thought, this is the sound. And funnily enough, Winwood I saw using one around the same time, just after he'd left, was about to leave Spencer Davis. He was playing a Strat. And then Hendrix. The problem was trying to find the maple necks. You know, they weren't that. You know, all the models that were current at that time had rosewood fingerboards. So they'd kind of gone out of circulation this end of the scene anyway. It wasn't until I went through the States on tour that I started picking them up in pawn shops and record shops for a song, you know, and I'd buy four or five at a time.
Anytime we do a tribute model, there's always this sense of reverence, you know, when you approach the instrument. And I remember being at EMP when we were doing the Hendrix Woodstock guitar, and I remember going through the exhibit and seeing Brownie was on display at that time, and seeing the guitar there with the case and everything, and just kind of going, wow, that's one that would be really cool to do. Whenever you do something like this, you have to respect that this is an artifact. It's not just somebody's guitar now, it's actually a rock and roll artifact, and so you have to approach it like that. You know, you wear white gloves and you're very, very careful with the guitar. We feel it's important to go through each guitar or instrument, whatever, it's a bass or a guitar. Todd and I went through everything, and the pickups are shielded. That changes the tone quite a bit when you do that. The electronics inside, the capacitors, how the wire is wound up and things like that.
We need to get that shot first.
With Blackie, it was a similar thing. And with Brownie, how the spread was laid out was really different, and we had no idea that the spread was laid out like that, so we had to go through and mark everything because it's an off-center seam, but it's three pieces of wood. As Blackie is too, it's three pieces of wood.
I think Brownie was the sort of prototype for Blackie, you know, in terms of what I was looking for in the ideal working guitar. And it was really that was the criteria, you know. Could I go on the road hard with this guitar, you know, every night of the week playing flat out, you know, and doing little bits of repair on it as I was going, you know, and refining it. What I would always look for on a Strat was a maple neck that had been worn out. You know, it was like a restaurant. If there's lots of people in there, you know, it's got to be good food. So I just thought if it had all those kind of worn out patches, it meant that it had been, you know, well favoured. I think I'd played a rosewood on a Jaguar or a Jazzmaster in the Yardbirds, and I didn't like the feel of it. It felt resistant to bending. It felt like the grain was quite prominent on a rose. You know, there was a definite feel to it, that where you felt like you were going across the grain if you tried to bend the strings. And I never got that. It was just like almost marble or something. It was so smooth.
Probably the most important part of the guitar is the neck. That's where your hand's always on. That's the first thing. When you pick it up by the neck. When you are playing, you know, that's the main focus point. And you just got to make sure every little thing is right, from the edges being rolled just right to the radius on the fingerboard, how the finish has been worn away, and not only on the back but on the fingerboard, because you feel it, especially with an instrument like this guitar. One of the other big things about Brownie is the finish and the sunburst, and it's a thicker sunburst. Jesus Andrade, who's our painter, he runs our paint department in the custom shop, and when he saw the guitar, he wanted to make sure that the sunburst was correct, so he actually sprayed a body and then went back and tweaked it, and we had great opportunity to have both guitars right there where you can kind of put them side by side, and it was really nice to see that happen.
The repro and Brownie takes me back to a state of mind and a state of capability that it was markedly different from what it is now. There's a lot involved. There's a nostalgic thing about my own journey, and let alone the journey of the guitar. The two things combined. And there was a meeting point, you know, where I was taking whatever it was I wanted to do and sort of cross-fertilizing that with what the history of the guitar. I mean, you know, doing those songs like It's Too Late, which, you know, is what I heard on the Buddy Holly album when he was playing that guitar, and there's the Chuck Willis R&B. But all these things were quite a powerful mixture. So that comes back to me, you know, when I pick up these guitars. That all comes back to me.
When I watched Eric, you know, play the guitar, and it was like, I was so happy because, you know, this guy knows. I mean, he knows, and to have him pick it up and go, yeah, that's it. You know, that really, that makes us all feel good. You know, I mean, that's a real, an honor for somebody to, like Eric, to pick up an instrument that we've made and go, yeah, we've knocked it out of the park.
Yeah, that'll do. Very nice.